drewsome is vicious.
So I woke up some time ago screaming and thought, I have a death wish. Why don't I make a video ranking Eminem albums?
That's an awfully hot coffee pot.
I started this script back in like October and I didn't finish it until February 12th because I'm a lazy shit. Anyway, this is what I wrote. Side note, this is just my opinion, and I'm not trying to tell anyone who disagrees with me that they're wrong. If you disagree with me, that's fine. Just leave a hateful comment or something. I don't know. Okay, let's go.
So YouTube claimed my video as usual. I uploaded this video on like March 11th, I think. It got claimed, like, obviously, like, immediately. I had like 16 different fucking claims on videos. So, I just put a dancing Thanos over it and just like flipped them, so hopefully that will throw off fucking Google Corp. Just ignore it, it doesn't matter. Fuck the copyright system. Okay, enjoy the video. Your booty is heavy duty,
like diarrhea of the plaster. I feel like this was inevitable. It's unfortunate how universally disliked Revival is. I remember when I was 17 and this album came out, I was really excited for it. I pre-ordered it on iTunes and I listened to it while I was at school, and at first I was like, oh, okay, this isn't that bad. Then I gave it a few more listens and realized that it was that bad. I don't want to repeat what everyone else has already said about this album, but it really does have some of the worst Eminem songs he's ever released. Granted, I adore the song Castle, I actually really love that song, but Bad Husband, Tragic Endings, Chloroseptic, the remix is fire though. This album was coming off singles like Campaign Speech, which I don't even think anybody remembers, Eminem's BET Cypher, which he rips Trump a new one, and the lead single Walk on Water, which in my opinion is one of the better cuts off this album. I think Untouchable and River were released early too, and dear God, why were they released early?
It's trash. One of the worst songs I've ever heard.
Eminem is still using the R slur on this album, and come on man. Untouchable sounds god-awful. I don't know who was hyping M up in the studio when he recorded this. I don't really mind the second half, if I'm being honest though. River sounds good, but it isn't. Ed Sheeran and Eminem just don't mix. The advertisement for this music video though was brilliant. Remind me. My god. I really don't like Bad Husband. I think the hook is terrible. The last verse isn't bad though. I'm not a fan of Tragic Endings. All Eminem and Skylar Grey songs sound the same. Framed is fine. It's very Relapse-y. I could go on and on about the whole tracklist, but for the sake of time, I won't. It's just sad because this album was coming 4 years after the release of a better Eminem album. We'll get to you later. And a lot had changed over those few years. I think it was a missed opportunity to create an extremely introspective album about a rapper who has somehow been able to maintain such a high standard of relevancy in an era where many get left behind after a few singles. A big criticism of this album that I never understood was, oh, we don't like that he's getting political. But like, what do you mean getting? Eminem was nothing but critical of the Bush administration on songs like White America and Mosh. I think Eminem being political should not come as a surprise to anybody. I will say though, this album does not discredit any of M's other work. A lot of people took this album and forever labeled him trash, what I think is really unfair to do to him and his legacy. Revival's like a 4 out of 10 for me. Here's a tracklist ranking. Next we have... Okay. Let me just say, I don't think Encore is a terrible album. I just don't think it's as nearly as good as the others. This was supposed to be Eminem's final record, coming at probably one of the worst times in his life. While the height of his addiction wouldn't come for another 3 years when he overdosed, he still was taking all sorts of drugs at the time, and I think this was apparent. I was 4 years old when this album came out, but looking back now at old concert footage and pictures, and comparing it to previous efforts, you can tell something was up. I think Encore's main problem is just how goofy it is. Eminem is no stranger to lowbrow, mindless comedy, but this album had a lot of it, and I think at some points it unintentionally overshadowed the heartfelt serious moments, like Mockingbird and Like Toy Soldiers. Songs like Rain Man, Big Weenie, Just Lose It, and Ass Like That all have very questionable spots on this album. Just Lose It and Ass Like That are two of my guilty pleasure songs, so I can't hate too much. Evil Deeds is fine, it's a fine intro. Never Enough is amazing, I don't care what anybody says. Do you hear that beat? The way M, 50, and Nate Dogg flow over this beat is great. The highlights of this album all really come in the first half, with the exception of like Mockingbird, but Like Toy Soldiers, Mosh, hell, even Puke can be labeled the better half of this album. My first single, Big Weenie, Rain Man, Spend Some Time, One Shot, Two Shot aren't even that bad, they're just forgettable, which I'll argue is worse. I think my favorite part of the album is the production. Those Dr. Dre beats hit really hard on songs like Never Enough, Mosh, and the title track, just to name a few. M's lyrics are fine for the most part, I just don't think they're as special as other entries on his list. I do cut M some slack because I can only imagine what shooting a movie, recording 4 albums simultaneously, and touring could be like. Resorting to sleep medication and getting addicted in the process, it's easy for us to be like, oh, he should have gotten the proper help because we weren't in his situation. I give Encore like a 5 out of 10. Here's the tracklist ranking, and what's next? Notice crack fiend Maxine, who needs a vaccine. She tests positive but tells you that her act's clean. If it's cool. Okay, what's next? I'm kidding. I just genuinely don't know what to say about this album. I hate to put it at such a low ranking, but to put this above all the others that have actual substance to them would be wrong. It sticks out from the rest for being the most different, but that doesn't make it bad at all. M's rapping and songwriting is still great. It truly is a piece of its time, with the boom bap drums on songs like Maxine, Searching, 313, and every other song. Boom bap was a thing. It's like trap drums today. But in all honesty, in my personal opinion, I don't think there's really much to this album. It's good, I enjoy it, and I still revisit it from time to time. It's more of a demo, and at the time, it was really just for M to show labels his talent. It's like a 5 to 6 out of 10. It's really not bad, but here's the tracklist ranking. Okay, I kinda love this album. Don't let its low ranking fool you, I bump to this album and revisit it quite often. Way more than Revival or Encore. I think the instrumentals are really dope and modern, which isn't a change for Marshall. He's had more contemporary beats since Revival, and even though I think he did great on Kamikaze, we'll get to you later, I think this is where he finally adapted to modern hip hop style.
So your booty is heavy duty like diarrhea?
Yeah.
I got a lot of shit for that line.
Right.
Pun intended. But it's like, when, oh man, that shit's trash, oh it's trash. I'm just being stupid.
Do you see me fucking laughing, my nigga? I ain't fucking laughing.
His flows and lyrics on songs like Godzilla, Unaccommodating, and You Gonna Learn are fucking great. The feature run on here is one of, if not the best, M has ever had on an album. Young M.A., Don Toliver, Slaughterhouse, Anderson .Paak, Juice WRLD, Black fucking Thought, and Q-Tip. Fuck yes. Even the theme, while not totally bringing back that old Slim Shady psychopath, is very OG. Music to be murdered by. I'm honestly surprised that we didn't get something like this sooner. His verse on I Will is also a highlight to me. I just thought I had to say that. While there is a lot about this album that I love, there also is some stuff I wasn't huge on, taking its spot at number 8. This critique gets thrown around a lot, but sometimes I feel like M doesn't stop talking about his haters. He's like, oh, I'm so hated because I'm the best. It's so annoying. Now look, I'm on Twitter, I see all the Eminem slander, but think about it like this. You can't expect the average Playboi Carti fan to recognize your lyrical greatness, M. I'm someone that likes all kinds of rap, so I can appreciate both. But stop acting like just because people don't like your music that they're dumb or it's too complex for them. Especially your newer music, man. It's not that deep. I also hate when he made Darkness, this great song about gun control, emphasizing all the deaths that have resulted from meaningless gun violence and calling for a change to be made, but then you say, but I'm contemplating yelling bombs away on the game like I'm outside of an Ariana Grande concert waiting. And look, I know actions speak louder than words, but M, this ain't 2002 no more. You can't say shit like this. I know we're not supposed to take Eminem bars like this too seriously, but it bothers me when you preach one thing and then make fun of it later on. I know I'm comparing shootings to bombings, but the point is, I don't think it's funny or edgy to make fun of dead teenage girls. I also don't really care for the love songs. In Too Deep, Farewell, Never Love Again, I don't know, man. M is almost 50, divorced twice, 3 daughters. I really don't want to hear about you piping someone in a car. You're my mom's age. It's gross. Those Kind of Nights is another example of this. Like, this literally sounds like a song that could have been on D12 World. And that's not a good thing. M, stop making music with Ed Sheeran. Y'all do not work together.
What? You fuckers. You fuckers.
You motherfucker, I will rain hellfire upon you.
On Marsh, I can't tell if M is mocking Travis Scott or not by doing his ablets. To my knowledge, M and Trav have mutual respect for each other. M even sent him a pair of Encore 4s. So what's good with this, M? Explain. Stepdad is kind of bad. I don't think I have to elaborate. And No Regrets is probably the most forgettable song on here, because it's not good enough to be a highlight, but it's not bad enough for me to hate. I will say, songs like Ya Ya, Little Engine, and Lock It Up get me pretty hyped. I love the cypher feeling of Ya Ya. I think Little Engine is a pretty good example of modern, kooky Eminem. And Lock It Up has so much swag. You really can't go wrong with Anderson .Paak. I was waiting on this collab for 5 years. I really do like Music to be Murdered By. Its low points aren't low enough to make me hate it, but in my opinion, its highs aren't high enough to rank it higher up. It's a 5 out of 10 for me. Here's a tracklist ranking. Okay, what's number 7? Okay, so, while writing this, M dropped the deluxe of Music to be Murdered By, and I feel like it'd be wrong of me to not include it. I'm gonna keep it ranked alongside the regular album itself, but I do have a few words to say about it. I think Music to be Murdered By is a fun album, but I don't think the deluxe adds anything special to it. To be honest, I could really take Zeus and Discombobulated and leave the rest. Even a song like Guns Blazing, I was excited to hear the first M and Dre collab since Medicine Man, but this just wasn't anything special to me, personally. So yeah, here's the tracklist ranking for that. Okay, now let's move on to number 7.
Give me my Ventolin inhaler and 2 Xenadrin, and I'll invite Sarah Palin out to dinner, then nail her.
Relapse is fucking weird. It's so hard for me to believe that this was M's comeback album after his 2007 overdose. What's even harder for me to believe is how much I like this album. I think it's intentionally all over the place, and I love the wild nature of it. I actually have vivid memories of seeing the refill commercial on TV as a kid. I had to be about 9. At that age, I really shouldn't have been listening to Eminem, but I was. There's honestly not much about this album I don't like, but the critiques I can give are about some of the lyrics on songs like My Mom, Insane, and Must Be the Ganja. In my opinion, they just fall short in comparison to others. Crack a Bottle is the lead single to this album, which is news to me because I always thought it was We Made You. Crack a Bottle is fine, but it won the Grammy over Amazing by Kanye and Jeezy, which is fucking bullshit. One thing that's weird for this album too is the lack of features. Up until this point, M was no stranger to having his friends on his albums, but the only features on Relapse are Dr. Dre and 50 Cent. Old Time Sake is great and Crack a Bottle is fucking fine, but for some reason D12 got cut from this album. B.O.B, I don't really care. Jasmine Sullivan, I think? I don't know if Cocaine was from this album or Recovery, just ignore me. I don't have a transition, so I'm just gonna talk about what I like. My favorite thing about this album, similar to Encore, is the production. It's really zany and fun, and this is extremely consistent with M's lyrical content. There's a lot of horns and hard-hitting drums that fit the narrative of this album perfectly. M's lyrics are weird and crazy, but I kinda love them. Songs like Bagpipes from Baghdad, Medicine Ball, and Stay Wide Awake are all off the handle, but I can't get enough of them. I know the accents are like a meme at this point, but to be honest, I always thought they were funny. Like, I never took it too seriously because I thought I wasn't supposed to. The 3 tracks on this album that I think are some of the best songs to come out of M's more modern work are Deja Vu, Careful What You Wish For, and Beautiful. They are easily the sore thumbs of this album, yet they fit so well. On Deja Vu, M details his fall from grace, but masks it with the eccentric beat and accent. But do not let that fool you. This song hits really hard, describing his daughters noticing his odd behavior, the devil on his shoulder, tempting him. And honestly, this heartbreaking line being my favorite part of the song. Careful What You Wish For is honestly a scary track to me. I'm an artist myself, and all I want is a status like Eminem, but this song makes me very hesitant. It starts with news recordings about everything M was going through in the last 4 years between his albums. Addiction, divorce, death. It seems like everything that could have been going wrong for him did. He wasn't catching a break. The second verse starts with M telling us how he had read a letter from a fan who said they were praying for him, and I truly believe that this was a big moment for him. He follows up with, "Why would someone pray for you when they don't know you?" And I kind of laugh a little every time I hear that because I picture Marshall going, "Oh, empathy." But seriously, I like to think that this simple note of somebody extending their kindness did a lot for Eminem. This song is heavy, but I want to move on to Beautiful, the last single from the album that wasn't really a single up until 3 months after the album's release. I think it's clear for anyone who has heard this song to understand why it's so important to this album. This is Eminem's telling of his drug addiction. It's so brutally honest, and I think it paints M in a light that we've obviously seen him in before, but not like this. He's vulnerable, he's scared. His post-rehab depression is tense and gloom. He finds it hard to laugh, he finds it hard to rap, finds it hard to just be alive. While this song was one of, if not the biggest sore thumb from Relapse, I think it truly captures what M's Relapse really was. 6 out of 10. I fuck with this album. Here's my tracklist ranking.
Suck my dick. You fucking suck, man. Suck my dick.
I'll probably get hate for this one, but I don't care. I love this album. There's way more stuff I like about this album than dislike, so let's get the bad stuff out of the way first. Nice Guy is one of the worst Eminem songs ever created. I don't want to hate on Jessie Reyes. I do like her. But here, I don't know what went wrong. Nothing on this song works. The beat, the lyrics, the vocals. M, listen, I fuck with you, bro. I wouldn't be making this video if I didn't. But you gotta stop acting like some of the criticism toward you isn't valid. I'm also not big on the love songs. Again, normal is whatever. The beat switch is cool. Good guy is better than nice guy. Nice guy is unlistenable, which we've established that already. Even for the sake of this video, I tried to listen to it and I only made it a minute and 10 seconds in. I just can't. As much as I love the song Kamikaze, I hate the line where he says, but the only reason I blow is 'cause I'm white, so why don't every other white rapper sell what I sold? And it's like, M, you came out at a time where there were no serious white rappers. They were all jokes. You were the first real white rapper, so of course you're going to sell more records than like fucking Vanilla Ice. That's it for the bad stuff, let's move on to the good stuff. This was M's first surprise album, coming out only 8 months after Revival, which at the time is something he had never done before. After Recovery, M was someone we kinda had to wait for. After Revival, I did not expect another album for another 3 to 4 years, but here we are. I was so excited when this album dropped, you wouldn't believe it. And on a first listen, I loved it, except for Nice Guy, but I loved it. On a second, I still really liked it, and on multiple more, I think this album still holds up pretty well. This is M's second shortest album, but unlike Infinite, these songs have a lot of substance, so I'm gonna quickly be talking about each one. Starting off with The Ringer, ignoring all the weird wall-punching lines, M goes insanely hard. His flows ride the beat perfectly, his lyrics are great, he's addressing the responses to Revival and going off on everybody. When that beat switches, and he starts talking about the BET cipher. Fuck, man. This is a great intro. Greatest is, well, great. Michael Made and M work really well together, and this song hits really hard, with funny lyrics and a crazy beat. Lucky You is honestly an unexpected collab with Joyner Lucas, who I've never been huge on, but I actually really love his verse here. I think he understood he'd be going toe-to-toe with M on this track, which meant he had to bring the heat. M still spits facts all over this track, and has, once again, a crazy good flow with crazy good lyrics over a crazy good beat. My only critique of this song is M isn't fully adapted to the modern rap sound like he is on Music to be Murdered By, so he sounds a little weird over the beat, but it's a minor nitpick. The Paul skit is self-aware, as usual, happy to see its return. The Response skit is pretty funny too. Stepping Stone is a really weird song. The hook isn't great, the drums are kind of annoying, and I think M had good intentions, but this just seems like he only cares about Bizarre, Swifty McVeigh, and Kniva because he may lose relevancy. Like when he says, I better stop and say my grace, something I pray that I don't fall, 'cause on the way back down I may end up running back into them all. Like, what the fuck? That's so selfish. Mr. Porter was the lucky one and got to stay with M for some reason. Not alike, or should I say, the shot heard around the world, is now infamous for being the real start of the MGK beef with M, name dropping and dissing him toward the end of the song. But even on its own, it's a fire song. I don't know why he parodied. What the fuck is that word? I don't know why he basically made a copy of the Look Alive beat, but it works. Let's take this opportunity to talk about Killshot. Let's just make this clear. If you think Rap Devil, the song where MGK said the real Slim Shady can't stand up, is a better diss track, and a song for that matter, than Killshot, you have no credibility. I've never been big on MGK, and this beef didn't change my opinion on him. If anything, it proved my point more for why I don't like his music. But Killshot is crazy. The disses Eminem drops on this undeniably shows that he still got it. Kamikaze as an album undeniably shows that he still got it. I'm very fond of the part where he says, had enough of this tatted up mumble rapper, how the fucking him and I battle? He'll have to fuck him in my flannel. I'll give him my sandals, 'cause he knows long as I'm shady, he's gonna have to live in my shadow. Fucking fire. Oh yeah, we were going through the track list. The title track is a lot of fun. I think the scratch break is really cool and makes me really happy to hear on an album that's only 2 years old. I honestly don't care much for the second half, to be honest. I know he's not dissing Drake, but do you blame people for thinking that? Fall is probably my favorite song on this album. Everything here just works. The beat is so hard. Bon Iver's hook fits so fucking well. M goes at everybody on this song. He's like Oprah, but instead of cars, it's disses. His flows are really fucking good. Even though this is my favorite song, it unironically is the one I take the most issue with. For those of you that know me, I'm a big Tyler Creator fan, and a big Earl Sweatshirt fan. It's not so much the fact that M dissed Tyler, but it's the word he called him. I know M apologized, but the fact that he backspun it shows that he knew what he was doing was wrong, yet said it anyway. I'm with Justin on this one. Side note, does anyone remember when this album came out on Apple Music and Kamikaze and Fall were switched? No? Just me? Okay. What's next? Nice guy? Nope. Good guy? Okay. Maybe this one isn't as bad. Okay, it's not that good, but it's not nearly as bad as Nice Guy. Good Guy is fine. I just really don't care for it. There's nothing about it that pops out to me. Nothing super special about it. If anything, the only good thing to come out of this song is at least Jesse Reyes' name is on an Eminem album. Even if the songs aren't great, it's cool to see a young artist working such a big one. And finally, one of the best songs ever written, Venom. This song is fine. I know it was for the movie, but M definitely wrote this song with way, way too much influence from the movie. It's the same reason songs like these work, and this one doesn't. Also, that R slur was backspun in the music video, yet still used on Music to Be Murdered By. But overall, Kamikaze is a pretty fucking good album. It has high highs and really low lows, but the highs are too good to overlook. 6.5 out of 10, here's the tracklist ranking. Let's move on to the top 5. Okay, now before I move on, I want to give a little bit of a warning. This is my opinion, meaning that what I am saying is not backed by facts. It is a personal preference. If you agree, cool. If you don't, cool. I don't care, and neither should you. Thanks for making it this far in the video, too, by the way. Wow.
Were you on crack?
Yeah.
Oh, you were. Dear. How'd you get off it?
I don't know, man. I kicked back and I got out the gutter, man, and I just...
Are you being serious, though? You really got off crack?
Nah,
no, okay.
Nah.
This album has no misses. This was M's commercial debut, and it's filled to the brim with hits. My Name Is, Role Model, Rock Bottom, Just and Still, Don't Give a Fuck. I honestly don't think I have anything too bad to say about this project. For a major label debut, the Slim Shady LP sets out its goals and accomplishes each one. The only songs on here that I don't love are Come On Everybody and My Fault. They're not awful, I just don't like them as much as others. I really don't have any critiques. I mean, this album is really good. One thing I think this album has too much of is skits. I think Paul is really all of us, and I think the story behind Bitch is hilarious, but I can really do without Lounge, Soap, and Ken Kniff. God, Ken Kniff. Although this album does have a hilarious intro that's followed by two of the biggest songs in hip-hop history. Guilty Conscience was nominated for Best Rap Performance by a duo, and My Name Is won Best Rap Solo Performance and Best Rap Album that year. I know a Grammy doesn't equal good, but in this case, I think it was definitely deserved. While M was not the first rapper or artist to push the envelope, he really flew off the handle sometimes. While most of it hasn't aged well, I do think sometimes we have to understand it was the time. It wasn't right, and it shouldn't have been accepted. But it was for some reason. 97 Bonnie and Clyde is a perfect example of this. M brought his infant daughter to the studio, recorded her, used those recordings on a song about him killing her mother and disposing of her body in front of her. Marshall! What the fuck was going through your head? I love the song, but bro! I guess maybe because I don't have kids, I don't fully understand that feeling that you would kill for your child if you had to, but I digress. Rock Bottom and If I Had are similar to this in the sense of you would do anything for your child, even using every dollar you have just to make them happy. Those are pretty touching moments of the album and really put M's views in perspective. I used to hear Rock Bottom when I was younger and realized the bubble of fucking suburbia I was in my whole life, but his album is great, and while it's not the best Eminem album, it definitely is the one with the least amount of problems. Does that make sense? Probably not. I don't care. 7 out of 10. Here's the tracklist ranking. Let's go to number 4.
And one more fucking thing. One more thing. The sun is beaming down, as hot as a motherfucker, and I'm about to get naked. Stay tuned.
Most of you probably saw this and clicked off the video, but I don't care, man. I love this album so much. There are, of course, a lot of valid criticisms of this album. I have a few myself, but there are also a lot that personally don't make sense to me. For starters, let's look to our almighty lord of correct and respectable music opinions. They say this album sounds devoid of any noticeable joy, personality, or wit. Well, for starters, let's look at joy. Is joy something you typically associate with overcoming drug addiction? Is joy something you typically associate with Eminem? Moving on.
Hey yo, what the fuck?
This album has no personality. I mean, sure, M talks about how he's been feeling since being completely sober, the internal struggles he went through relating to his status in hip-hop, and how his personality has basically done a complete 180 since his overdose. But nah, this album has no personality. Shame on you, Marshall. Pitchfork, no likey. I'm not even gonna go over wit. Give me a fucking break. People say this album is weak in terms of technical skill and like, okay. Every song sounds great to me, except for White Trash Party. So I don't really care that he didn't rhyme 80 words together in 7.2 seconds. But fuck all that. Let's look at the stuff that I personally don't like. Their production is a little clunky in some areas. Won't Back Down sounds like a ripoff Rage Against the Machine song. Some parts on Seduction sound kinda whack. 25 to Life kinda sounds like he went to YouTube and typed in Eminem type beat. Fun fact, the guy who made that beat graduated from my high school. I'm not kidding. Hold on, my girlfriend's FaceTiming me. Hello?
Hi.
Hello. Even some parts on Not Afraid sound weird, but we'll get to that song later. The song right here also falls short in some places. Cold Wind Blows, On Fire, and Untitled are just a few examples. Like I said, I could care less about technical ability, but technical ability and lyrics fall in the middle of the Venn diagram for me. The only song on this album I don't like is White Trash Party. It's just kinda lame, and this is the style I don't care for from Eminem. But with all that out of the way, let's move on to the stuff I like. M's attitude on this album is great. He's ready to dive headfirst right back into rap, and boy does he strike a landing! Songs like Cinderella Man and No Love show M going hard as hell over these beats, and it's so great. I like the storytelling approach on songs like Talking to Myself and Going Through Changes. While I love Going Through Changes, it's your typical slow, sad string song. Talking to Myself is pretty fast-paced and more upbeat, contrasting M's hard-hitting lyrics. The biggest mind-blow of this album to me is the lead single, Not Afraid. This song truly showcases us a new Eminem that we were not used to. Eminem saying, the Eminem from 10 years ago, prior, would never say this kind of shit. He didn't give a fuck about anybody besides himself and his daughter. So hearing him extend his hand in such a vulnerable time in his life is definitely worth noting. I really like this album. I know most people don't like it, and that's okay, but I give it a 7.5 out of 10. Here's the tracklist ranking. Also, Love the Way You Lie is fucking great. I didn't put that in the script, but it's fucking great. How could you not like that song? Okay, what's next?
You have reached the voicemail box of
Suck It.
This album was the most anticipated record of my life as of 8 years ago. But to be honest, it still holds up. I was 13 when this album came out, and I'll never forget the excitement my friends and I felt when it finally released. I have very few bad things to say about this album, so let's get those out of the way so I can geek out. Rick Rubin and Eminem don't mesh very well together in my opinion. I don't know how much involvement he had in this, but it wasn't enough to destroy the album. No disrespect to Rick, he's a legend. M wasted a Kendrick Lamar feature on Love Game, and I'll never forgive him for that. The features, Skylar Grey, as usual, but with ex-ambassadors and Jamie N. Commons, yeah, him too. And M singing on songs like Rhyme or Reason and Stronger Than I Was, ew. Borrow some of Wayne's autotune, bro, you need it. Those are really my only complaints, so let's jump right into the good stuff. This album starts with the sequel to Stan, and this was such a fun and cool way to open the album. The last verse is so cinematic, and the record is treated like more of an event than an album. The parking lot skit continuing the bank robbery from Criminal, I just love it. This was still when M was yelling for no reason, but to be fair, it kind of fits this album. Like on songs like So Much Better and Brainless, he's truly giving it his all, and you can tell. I really like the little introspective lyrics on songs like So Far and Evil Twin, and talking about how he's been around for so long that he's basically disconnected from pop culture is kinda badass. To be such a prominent figure in pop culture, but to barely engage in it is like Frank Ocean levels of cool. The lead single to this album is Berserk, and I still remember when this song came out. This shit slapped! And Survival! I went to GameStop just to pre-order some Call of Duty game just so I could get the Buckshot bonus track, which is extremely underrated by the way. Monster has a fun song with Rihanna, shout out to John Bellyman, and Rap God, oh my god, Rap God! My friend and I listened to this song for the first time on the bus to a school trip, and we couldn't believe how fast M was rapping. This shit had us ascending. While I wasn't head over heels for Too Many of the Deluxe song, Beautiful Pain is by far one of the best and should have made it on the regular version of the album. Headlights is a song I have to mention. Remember how I talked about M's growth on Not Afraid? Well, this song takes it to the next level. From this point in his career, M has continuously dissed his own mother in song after song, not to mention cleaning out my closet, we'll get to you later. But after all the disses, the lawsuits, and the bullshit, M finally forgives his mother. After going through a drug addiction like her, he finally is able to walk in her shoes and understand why she was the way she was. And he forgives her. This song is really beautiful and is such a rewarding and heartwarming thing to hear as a longtime Eminem fan. But also, my favorite song on here probably has to be Legacy. I adore the piano, the hook, the lyrics, some of my favorite coming from the second verse. I love how M starts as very muffled and soft, and by the end he's yelling. It's honestly Shakespearean. I know people shit on this album and deem it an unworthy sequel, but I don't know, man. If you expected M to be the same exact person he was 13 years prior to this album, I think you're the problem. The beauty behind calling it the Marshall Mathers LP is showing that this album represents him. Here's him then, here's him now. See the difference? 8 out of 10. Here's the tracklist ranking. Now for the non-controversial picks.
When you gotta stop living up here, start living down here.
It's 7:30 in the morning, dog.
The Eminem Show is one of my favorite albums ever. This album is filled to the brim with fun features, classic Dre beats, infectious hooks, and classic zany Eminem. My favorite thing about this album are its singles, which are arguably the best songs here. Without Me, Cleaning Out My Closet, Superman, Business, and Sing for the Moment. We have a lot to unpack with you later. As usual, let's do the bad things first. Bizarre is on this album. Well, that's all I have to say about the bad. Let's go into the good. Now that we're in the top two, I'll try to go through every song in a brief amount of time. The first song is White America, and it's really sad that a song from 19 years ago about racism in the music industry still holds up today. Failure. You already know this song is great. From the clever lyrics, calling out politicians, and the instrumental, oh my god, this instrumental is amazing. Eminem's lyrics here truly showcase the racist habits of not only those in the music business, but of regular music listeners too, seeing that if his eyes were brown over blue, his album would sit on the shelf. I like how he compares and contrasts the battle rap scene he came up in the commercial level he's at now. Underground, the problem was that he was white. No one took him seriously. As an artist on a major label, the color of his skin actually benefits him, and helps him get bigger, even if other artists who are black might be doing better than him musically. Great song, you already know. Business is so much fun. What is this song about? I don't know, but it fucking bangs. It's like about M and Dre being superheroes or something. I don't know, you know this song is great. Cleaning Out My Closet is one of M's biggest songs ever, which nowadays I think is to his dislike. Eminem pulls no punches in the attack on his mother, talking about her popping pills, wishing her own son were dead, to even saying that her own granddaughter wouldn't attend her funeral. Eminem really did channel Kyle energy back in the day. But in all seriousness, as heartbreaking and disturbing as this song might be, you can obviously tell Eminem poured his sweat and tears into it. It's a notorious song that only continues to live on, then right after comes Square Dance. Woo! This is another instance of Business, but like, with some anti-draft, anti-war messaging. Mwah! But I really like how silly this song is, also while being super serious. Cause on one hand, you have Eminem doing a really bad southern accent, and on the other, you have him criticizing the US government and current affairs at the time. Again, I really love this song. Always have, always will. Soldier, the song that sparked a million Instagram captions. Give me a fucking break. Nah, this song is awesome. M was dealing with a lot of legal trouble at the time, and this song reflects a lot of that. I really like the hook, and M sounds as aggressive as ever, which makes for a crazy delivery. Say Goodbye to Hollywood has probably the catchiest hook on here, in my opinion. It gets stuck in my head at least once a month. I love the different approach and how this song contradicts the prior. It's an extremely personal ballad about M, his wife, his daughter, and his fame. It's truly beautiful. I really like this part, I think that's worth noting. Drips is a little weird. It's probably my least favorite song on the album, but that doesn't make it bad. The Obie Trice feature is great, and I think it's just the subject matter that's weird. Like, what was so cool about making a song about this back in 2002? M was like, I got an STD, and everyone was like, bars! I don't know, it's fine, definitely better than some of M's newer songs about women, but I digress. Without Me, the breakout single. Everyone knows this song. Everyone's mom knows this song. It's just that good. The music video is so wild, it's amazing, the beat is infamous, the guess who's back has become an iconic line, his lyrics are so fun and zany, he's truly right when he says that music would feel so empty without him. This was and still is one of M's best songs, and I don't see how anyone can disagree. Superman is a pretty fun Mariah Carey diss, cause not only is it an excellent diss track, but a great song. There's a big difference between the two that people don't typically realize. This was a music video I used to have to be sneaky with, the uncensored version was on Daily Motion. Haley's song is really touching and paints a sad truth about custody battles. M's singing isn't actually that bad here, never thought I'd say that. Eminem is many things, but one of those things is not a bad father. I will forever stand by that. When the music stops is good, but honestly just goes on for too long. Maybe he's just bizarre, man. I don't know. He seriously ruined so many D12 songs, and this verse from him is so whack. Like, what the fuck are you talking about? Give me a version without Bizarre, and this song will be better. Also, side note, one time freshman year of high school theater, I did M's verse in this song for a monologue, and my teacher liked it so much, he insisted I do it for not one, but two auditions. I got the role of Marcellus in Hamlet from this song, and I'm not making that shit up. I swear. Anyway, back to Marshall. Say what you say, fucking bumps. M and Dre trade bars, and this is aimed at Cannabis, Jermaine Dupri, and The Source Magazine, and God, are they good! Their flows and jabs dig deep and go so hard. I love hearing Dre rap so aggressively. Eminem pulls no punches in his verses. This dynamic duo maintains their level of respect in hip-hop. Till I Collapse has become classic. I don't know anyone who doesn't love this song. It's so cinematic with Nate Dogg's hook to the beautiful instrumental, and most of all, M's inspiring lyrics. I know the third verse has become a lost art in hip-hop, but it's so hard for me to hear this and picture it without the third verse. It's arguably the best part. The last song on here is My Dad's Gone Crazy, and I know a lot of people are critical of this being the outro opposed to Till I Collapse, but to be honest, I think it fits. It's a weird song, tone-wise, but other than that, I think it's kinda cute. For the most part, that is. It has a fun beat and funny ad-libs from Haley. I think Haley's Your Funny Daddy is the most appropriate way to end this album. You may have noticed I skipped the song. I was waiting for the end for this one because it's my favorite song on the album and my second favorite Eminem song ever. Sing for the Moment. This is such a carefully crafted, beautiful song that paints what I like to think was exactly how M felt during this time. No exaggerations, no shortcomings, his pure, unfiltered headspace. This is what M said about this song a couple years ago. I may not be shit to you, but there's a kid in fucking Nebraska or somewhere that I'm talking to. I don't care if you're listening, because he's listening. That's who I'm directing my material at. And this captures the whole essence of this song. The way M and Jeff Bass, or Bass, I don't fucking know how to say your name, flip the Aerosmith sample, the bass that you can feel in your chest, the lyrics that make the hairs on your arm stand up. The third verse of this song is one that has made me cry and gives me chills every time I hear it. Its message about the importance of hip-hop to so many people, especially younger listeners, reached millions of people. All I can say for that is, thank you, Marshall. Here's the tracklist ranking, 9 out of 10. On to number one pick. The Marshall Mathers LP is my favorite album of all time. I pull a lot of inspiration from a lot of different places, hip-hop being where I pull the most inspiration from. But compared to all my other favorites, nothing has opened my eyes the way this album did. The first time I listened to this album in its entirety while fully understanding the subject matter, I was 13. It's no coincidence that at 13, I realized I was meant to make music. There's a lot I have to say about this album, so I'll try to be as organized as possible, and like the last review, I'll be saving my favorite song for the end. This album starts with Slim Shady having someone else tell you that he doesn't care what you think. He doesn't care so much, he had to have someone else tell you. This record is a trip. The first song, appropriately titled Kill You, is exactly that. This track is basically a response to a lot of M's critics at the time, and he takes so many jabs at his mom, his ex-wife, and calls out really anyone that tries to oppose him. His flow, the beat, what hasn't been said about this song? It's such a killer opening that pulls no punches and perfectly introduces us to music we're about to hear. Stand is one of M's best songs. Some people claim that this is the best song he ever wrote, and it's a valid pick. It's songs like these where M's storytelling shines and paints a full picture in your head. The Dido hook is perfect, and I can't hear Thank You without hearing this song. For a long time, there were theories about this song being a true story, and while someone didn't drive off a bridge with their pregnant girlfriend in the trunk, M has said that this song is based on people writing to him, taking his violent lyrical content seriously. It is unfortunate that M had to tell people his lyrics were just for shock value and nothing more, but at least we got this masterpiece of a song out of it. I can go on and on about this song forever. The hook is beautiful, the bassline is so catchy, accompanied by the loose guitar in the background. M's use of sound effects also helps the listener visualize the song more. Hearing the pencil on the paper that storm getting louder and louder as the song progresses, and the car splashing into the water. This song is perfect and will forever be timeless, which might not be a good thing. I know I've been avoiding the skits, but the Paul skit on this album is my favorite, and I think it's so funny. This is what I imagine my producer thinks while mixing. I once had a friend text me about Who Knew and said that this part were some of the best lyrics he'd ever heard. Chad Antonio, I love you, bro. But seriously, who knew touches on some of the same themes as Stan, that people blame his lyrics on why others may engage in senseless acts of craziness, and points out how stupid his argument is, and even says the media focuses more on an artist's lyrical content than the sex scandals of the president. That was true for then and today. The Way I Am is another perfect example of the Slim Shady persona. If you say he's an asshole, he'll be an asshole. If you say you love him, then he'll love you. He really said, fuck the media, think whatever you want of me. This is something we still see from rappers, but not as much or as abrasive as M. This song has become a classic, and even if you're only a little familiar with M's music, you probably know and like this song. Speaking of classics, the real Slim Shady is the real classic of this album. How can you not love this song? It's serious yet hilarious at the same time. We get amazing flows and lyrics. The beat is infamous and instantly recognizable. The name drops are all hilarious when he just says fuck you to Will Smith. I love Will Smith, but that's hilarious. The music video is so chaotic, and I think M didn't want this to be the lead single, which is jarring to me. If My Name Is didn't make Slim Shady a household name, then this song definitely did. Remember Me seems to be the song from this album that no one really talks about, and while RBX and Sticky Fingers' verses aren't bad by any means, I'll be honest, I usually skip to M's verse on this song. His flow and rhyme scheme over the boom bap drums are a lot of fun, and while not as shocking or clever as others, still fits the tone of the album great. I'm Back is one of my favorites from this record. M's lyrics on here range from really funny to really gross. I also can't believe that this song has a clean version, an explicit version, and an uncut version. The uncut version with the Columbine lyrics are hard to find, but there are some fan edits on YouTube. I made it all the way to the third page of Google, and I couldn't find the legitimate version, so. But I really do love this song. It carries the same message as the rest of the album. M doesn't give a fuck, but the execution on here stuck out to me specifically because of the lyrics. Drug Ballad slaps, you guys are just dumb. I've seen people hate on this song, and I truly don't understand why. Nah, but seriously, this song has a really funky bassline to it and cool drums. The lyrics aren't really anything deep, it's just about M doing crack, but hey, it slaps. Okay, this next one might surprise you, but I don't hate Amityville. Like, yeah, Bizarre's verse is dumb, but it's short, and it's over before you can even process it. M's verses are cool, I like the yelling, and think the lyrics are pretty good. Fun fact, I live a town over from Amityville, where the song is named after. Please don't come to my house. Bitch Please 2 is so fucking groovy. Bitch Please 1 cannot hold a candle to this song. It's dope, but it ain't as dope as the sequel. I will argue with anyone that this is better. The beat makes your head nod uncontrollably. It's a classic West Coast gangster rap feel, and the dream team on this song. M, Dre, Snoop, Exhibit, Nate Dogg, sheesh. This shit is great. Every verse from every artist honestly goes really hard, and Dre and Snoop get to exchange some classic chronic bars. Nate Dogg gets to handle this fire hook. X talks his shit, and that body bag line is fire. M delivers as always. His verse is so fun. This song is great. Probably my top 5 from this album. I'm gonna break character for a second to talk about Kim, because the story and aftermath of this song are honestly not something I should joke about or speak of loosely. Just a warning, I'm gonna be talking about these topics that you see on screen, so if any of these may trigger a response, feel free to skip to this timestamp. In 2007, 7 years after the song was released, Kim did a story in People magazine where she shared her suicide attempt story. While the song was awful, Kim said that M had promised to never do the song live. Much to her dismay, he did it, and it led Kim to harm herself so badly that she had to be hospitalized. Seeing the crowd's response and everybody cheering, singing the words and laughing, it just felt like everyone was staring at me. I knew it was about me, and that night when I went home, I tried to commit suicide. I also failed to mention that while performing the song, M was beating up a blow doll that resembled her. Kim has still been dealing with her own mental health issues, and I honestly wish her the best. As of a few years ago, I believe her and Marshall were said to be on good terms, which is great. But yeah, no real review of this song, you all know it. Those are my thoughts. Under the Influence is another song that isn't bad by any means, but also isn't one of my favorites. The beat is probably the best part of this song, although I think this song has my favorite Bizarre verse. It's the only one on this list that I can actually listen to all the way through. I don't really have much to say about this song, it's fine. I mentioned it before that I feel like D12 songs go on for too long, and this is a perfect example of that. The outro to this album is criminal, and that song is fucking great. Reciting the same words from the end of the Slim Shady LP, talking about people asking him stupid questions, and saying if you think he kills people, then he'll kill you. Another song that perfectly captures the alter ego that is Slim Shady. It has a really catchy hook, really fun and eccentric verses, is overall a killer outro for this masterpiece of an album. M's flows and rhyme schemes on this song are honestly some of the best on the album. This album ending with a gunshot is so fitting. So like the Eminem Show, I saved my favorite for last, and that song is the title track. track Marshall Mathers. I feel like this song perfectly captures what this album is about. It's not about Slim Shady, it's not about Eminem, it's about Marshall Mathers. This is one of the most personal songs that M has ever released, and it covers his life before and during the fame, speaking on his mom's defamation lawsuit against him, talking about how his deadbeat father and his half-siblings never bothered to reach out to him until his rise to stardom, even saying now that he's finally rich and famous, he's allowed in Kim's parents' house. The hook of this song is the core of the album. He's just Marshall Mathers, a regular guy that nobody ever cared about. So what's all the fuss about now? The eerie guitar solo at the end is a perfect closure to this song that, for me, is the definitive song from this record. And with that being said, here's the tracklist ranking. 10 out of 10. Now, a quick more personal message to my main man Marshall. Em, can I call you Slim? You're one of my favorite artists of all time. I love your music, even through my critiques. I know a lot of people give you shit, but there's still a ton of us who love you. I have my personal problems with your music, but at the end of the day, it's your music. You can do whatever the hell you want with it. Cause no matter what I say, or what anyone says, or even what Anthony Fantano says, we're all gonna listen. Just like my other favorites like Tyler or Kendrick, I'm always gonna listen, have my own personal critiques, but that's just how it is, man. Go listen to my music, I'm sure you'd have a problem with that. But that's okay. People's opinions are just that. Opinions. Keep doing you, Em. We're all rooting for you. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed, please consider subscribing. If you'd be so kind, leave a like, leave a comment, share the video. I don't care. I'm just having fun.